Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting in 2024 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Michael Marra will be joining us remotely. Before we move to our first item, I want to record the committee's thanks to those who took the time to meet with us as part of the Inter-Parliamentary Finance Committee Forum visit to Portcullis House in London last Thursday. I'm sure I speak on behalf of all members involved when I say how worthwhile our meetings were with Treasury Committee MPs and Public Administration and Constitutional Affairs Committee Chair William Ragg MP, and also with David Gawk, the Office for National Statistics and Institute for Government, as well as our Welsh colleagues. And look forward to meeting with our Welsh and Northern Ireland counterparts again later this year, possibly in Belfast. The first item on our agenda today is to take evidence from the Scottish Government Bill Team in relation to the Financial Memorandum for the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. For this session, we are joined by Scottish Government officials Graeme Thompson, Head of Legislation and Divisional Development, and Stephen Bunch, Bill Team Leader. I welcome you both to the meeting and invite Graeme Thompson to make a brief opening statement. Good morning, Mr Thompson, and over to you.
Good morning, Convener, and thank you for having us on today to provide evidence and to take your questions. We recognise there's a difference between the costs set out in the financial memorandum and the evidence that you've received as a committee, and I can confirm that we're working to revise that financial memorandum with the intention of publishing a revised version after stage two. So the cost estimates set out in the financial memorandum were informed by extensive discussions with our policing partners, in particular Police Scotland, the Police Investigations and Review Commissioner, and the Scottish Police Authority, and also through the Scottish Police Consultative Forums, where statutory staff associations, such as the Scottish Police Federation, were able to set out their views. These discussions were complemented by written evidence and desk-based research that we undertook, and through liaison with His Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland, the Home Office and the London Mayor's Office, all to help us sense check the information that we'd received. There are three main differences between the financial memorandum and the evidence you've received. Firstly, training costs. As we prepared the financial memo, Police Scotland told us these costs would likely to be able to be absorbed. However, as you can see, they've now adjusted that position. This is partly due to the wording of the statutory responsibility that's been placed on the Chief Constable in the bill, and partly as a result of a more robust approach that they're taking within Police Scotland to assess the impacts of new legislation across the board. We're working with them to fully understand the training requirements and their financial impact, and will reflect that work within the revised financial memo. The second area of difference is staff costs associated with the anticipated increase in the number of gross misconduct cases. We accept that there will be a need to increase resources in Police Scotland's professional standards department to support the bill's provisions, and intend to capture that in the revised memorandum. And the final area of difference is in legal costs for former officers, which is dependent on the estimates of the number of additional cases and an average cost to support an individual's attendance at a hearing. We relied on information provided to us by both the Scottish Police Federation and Police Scotland in preparing the financial memo, and recognise that these costs have now been revised by those organisations, and will also reflect that in the updated financial memo. Overall, the information gathered via the call for evidence is reflective of a greater understanding of the impacts of the bill, which we will draw on to update the financial memo after stage two. And so we'd welcome any questions you may have.
Well, first of all, I have to say I'm quite astonished that the updated financial memorandum is planned for after stage two. I mean, financial memorandum should be with us updated before stage one of any bill going forward. I don't think that's really appropriate at all, and I would hope that work will be done to ensure that does actually happen. Secondly, I'm quite surprised by the fact that the figures that are actually used in the financial memorandum relate to September 2022. Now, that's 18 months ago, and as the Police Scotland pointed out in their submission, you know, at that time, inflation, I think, peaked at 11.2% a month after that. So surely steps should have been taken, even if one does not agree with the costings that Police Scotland have provided, that it should have been updated long before now.
Well, the bill was introduced into Parliament in May, June last year, and it was at that stage we used the information provided us by Police Scotland. We accept that we accept what Police Scotland said about inflation. We accept that inflationary costs and pay has increased for Police Scotland and will reflect that. Indeed, we'll take advice from committee about when would be the best time to bring back a financial memorandum. Indeed, we are already working with those policing bodies to update it. We're already in a position where we can update some of the information and would seek to do that at the earliest opportunity. It was our understanding that that was likely protocol that would normally be after stage two.
From this committee's perspective, a financial memorandum, if members are going to be deliberating the general principles of a bill, it's appropriate that the Finance Committee scrutinises the financial memorandum, an updated financial memorandum, before it goes to lead committee, before it goes to stage one. As far as I'm aware, that's the way it's always been done. That's the way it should be done. It certainly shouldn't be done after stage two. And I understand your point that the bill was presented in June last year. That makes me even more bewildered that nine-month-old figures were being used when clearly everyone knew that inflation was high, and even more so that there's been 9 months to update it since then, and we've been presented with a set of figures that actually don't really mean anything. I mean, they don't, we could go through it all, and I sat here actually, with all my nice wee bits all yellowed with questions to ask about that, but you're effectively saying that the financial memorandum, all how many pages of it, 22 pages of it, really isn't worth the paper it's written on at that stage. Would that be a fair assessment?
I think it's fair to say that we're updating, we look to update parts of it. I wouldn't accept that it's not worth the paper it's written on, but I do think there are elements that we will update, and that's in line with the particular sections we drew out in that opening statement.
But why has it not been updated before now?
It wasn't until the evidence that you received through your call for evidence that we had that updated information. So while we've worked closely with Police Scotland, they did not supply that information to us in advance of providing it to you for the call for evidence.
And you don't have any other sources of information? I mean, other than the fact that you were clearly aware that, I would have thought there would at least have been an inflationary uplift over the last 18 months, even given the caveat that you've made with regard to submissions from Police Scotland and others.
There are certain elements that are subject to inflationary uplift. So, and I take your point that we could have potentially updated that at an earlier point, but that isn't the case across the whole financial MO. And I'll be honest, we are reliant on some of the information that we've received from, in particular, from Police Scotland and other policing bodies in shaping this. And we are reliant on them providing the information either to us or to yourself through your call for evidence.
Okay, so how did you come to the figures that you do actually have in the financial memorandum before the Police Scotland made the submission, given the fact that you're saying you're so heavily reliant on what they've provided?
So we worked closely with Professional Standards Department in Police Scotland and have done over a considerable period of time. I mentioned in my opening statement that they are taking Police Scotland are taking a different approach to how they calculate how they assess financial impact, and what they did prior to us producing the financial memorandum is they were very much concentrated on the impacts on Professional Standards Department alone. What they have done since then is consider the impacts right across the organisation. So, for example, when it comes to training costs in relation to the introduction of code of ethics or a duty of candour, then they are considering that across the piece. They had previously told us that that would be absorbable, that would be a cost that wouldn't be they would be able to absorb, but they have now adjusted that position. So we accept that there's a case to be made for that, and are working with them to understand that full impact.
Yeah, I mean, Police Scotland are saying it's going to cost near £5 million in the figure in the financial memorandum. That's more than three times what's actually said in the financial memorandum. So do you think the police are more accurate than the financial memorandum we have before us?
I think there is elements of that that are more accurate. So I broke it, my opening statement, down into three parts, and when it comes to the legal costs and staff costs associated with the anticipated increase, they have increased, and we, broadly speaking, accept what they're saying there. There is still some ongoing discussion with Police Scotland about that training elements, largely because the costs that they've set out include opportunity costs, so they include the costs because officers will be doing other things as a result of, they will be concentrating on the training rather than doing other tasks, rather than any direct costs.
Okay, colleagues are quite keen to come in, incidentally, but I mean, one of the things that you've talked about is the £10,000 benchmark for materiality, which, and I quote, takes into account the relative cost of changes in proportion to the overall budget of the affected organisations and the difficulty in being precise when dealing with smaller estimates. But this approach to presenting costs as material and immaterial and the use of the £10,000 figure as a benchmark is not the usual approach taken with Scottish Government financial memorandums. Now, we're, as a finance committee, we're trying to interrogate apples with apples and not apples with pears. So why have you decided to use that approach, which isn't normally used in financial memoranda?
We'll let Steve come in a second, but generally speaking, we adopted that approach because there was a little bit of uncertainty as to some of the costs. We recognise that actually costs can only ever be best estimates, so we accept that we could phrase that in a different way, and if that's not in line with other financial memoranda, then we will seek to specify costs where we can and provide better estimates where we can. We are talking about things that were considered there as very low amounts, and Steve can potentially provide some examples.
Yeah, very low amounts, but very low amounts can be cumulatively large amounts. So they have to come out of somebody's budget.
Yeah, so the types of costs that we're looking at was things like consultation costs with the stakeholders for the Code of Ethics, and what we thought was, if we weren't sure exactly what those costs were at that low level, but if we were to assume them at £10,000, then that would take account of those costs. But as Graeme says, we can look to remove that element from the revised memorandum if that's something that the committee wishes.
Okay. Now, paragraph 27, you know, of the financial memorandum, it says the figures contained within this financial memorandum are the Scottish Government's best estimates of the costs of the provisions of the bill, but clearly that's not the case, is it?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
Yeah, I'll quote from the financial memorandum, paragraph 27. It says here, the figures contained within the financial memorandum are the Scottish Government's best estimates of the cost of the provisions of this bill, but they're not, are they? So, I mean, they're nowhere near the costs.
Yeah, so the financial memorandum at the point in time, that was the best estimates that we could get from the information that partners gave to us.
Right. Okay.
Just to come in on top of that, overall, those costs that we considered, wrote down as immaterial. In some ways, we potentially could have described that as absorbable. But those costs were included in the overall figure.
Now, once again, we're in a situation, and I think we're in a kind of Groundhog Day position in this committee, with whereby. And it says here on page 33, many of the bill's provisions require secondary legislation to be fully implemented. Why are they not being included in primary legislation?
So I'll start off with that one and then bring in Steve in a second. There is the bill is an enabling and framework bill, and there are a number of provisions that are going to be set out in secondary legislation. I accept that there is more that we could potentially do to outline some of those costs, but there's a key element here, which is that when it comes to conduct regulations, which is going to be some of the things that are going to get introduced by secondary legislation, we have to do that as set out in legislation through consultation with the Scottish Police Consultative Forum. That's those statutory staff associations like the Scottish Police Federation, who are so everything that is in the terms and conditions of an officer's employment is set out in regulations rather than in employment contract as it would be with other with police staff or most other professions. So as part of that acceptance, there's an agreement that everything can only be done through the Scottish Police Consultative Forum. So in some ways, we have not gone through that process, and that process that we go through with the Scottish Police Consultative Forum may well change what is or isn't in those that secondary legislation, because that should be done via agreement through that forum.
Okay, I mean, and you've said in that same kind of paragraph 33 that it's not possible to provide a full assessment of costs or savings until the regulations have been agreed. But when one looks at the table one, you've given a figure of £1,414,474. So you've actually put quite precise figures into this table, despite the fact that you've admitted that it doesn't actually bear any real relation to what the costs are actually going to be. It just seems very odd to be so precise in a document which is so imprecise, you know.
I take your point about the precise nature, and as part of the work that we're undertaking to look again at the financial memorandum, I think that where we aren't able to be as precise, we're likely to provide a bit more evidence in range form.
Okay, just one more question before opening out to colleagues around the table, and that's, when can we expect an updated financial memorandum with more accurate costings?
Well, as I said at the beginning, we were intending doing that after stage two, because that was our understanding of when
it will this committee. So when can we have it?
We can work to a quicker timescale, and we can. We know that the Criminal Justice Committee are undertaking their stage one work throughout prior to summer recess, and we can work to that timetable.
Okay, thank you. I'll now open up to colleagues. The first to ask questions will be Liz, followed by Michelle.
Thank you. Good morning. Mr. Thompson, the problem that we have with this committee, as the convener has quite rightly pointed to, is that we're being asked to scrutinise the numbers that have to go behind a bill. And this is the fourth bill in recent months for which we have got concerns, because the accuracy of the numbers do not suit the scrutiny that we've got to provide. Do you accept that when it comes to being a bill team to make a presentation to Parliament, it is essential that the financial memorandum that goes with that bill is understood and clearly set out before we get to any legislative process? Do you accept that as a bill team?
As a point in principle, it's absolutely our intention as a bill team to try to make sure that the information presented is as accurate as possible.
So just why then did you consider it, or originally consider it appropriate, not to provide us with that updated financial memorandum until after stage two? Where's the logic in that?
I think it's a misunderstanding on my part. I think that we'd understood that protocol dictated that it wouldn't happen to that. I would point out again that it wasn't until you received your call for evidence that we could. That we have the information to enable us to update that.
But it's a long-standing convention of this Parliament, rightly so, and as the convener has rightly set out, that the financial memorandum must be presented in time for the legislative process. That is not after stage two. And if it's a misunderstanding, then obviously we've got to correct that very quickly. But can I suggest that there is a wider problem here? Because we have to ensure that any legislation that we do pass in this Parliament is fit for purpose, that it is good law. Whether we parties vote in favour or against the bill, that's not the main point. The main point is about whether it is factually correct and whether the evidence supports it. Now, at the moment, I think it's very difficult for us to understand why a bill team thought it was appropriate to come with the numbers after stage two, which is after a committee stage, as well as the stage one debate in the Parliament. Do you accept that we are right to have these concerns?
I absolutely accept. We, we, it would be my intention to bring forward a revised financial memorandum as soon as it is possible or practical to do so. And the stage two that was reflected in my opening statement was not born out of anything other than that's what I understood the protocol to be. So if that's not the case, as you clearly are setting out, then we would we'll work to do that as soon as we possibly can. Bring back our revised financial.
I think that would be very helpful. Can I just pursue another part of this, which is related in that I don't know how many framework bills we have in this Parliament just now, but it's a lot. And my understanding from a Scottish Government perspective is that one of the reasons for framework bills is to try to ensure that there is as much discussion between government and the relevant stakeholders to try to co-design, I think the right phrase is, that the Scottish Government uses. In other words, we've got a better chance of getting good legislation if the stakeholders have had really good input to that. That's my understanding, and I think that's the understanding that this committee has. The problem is that the co-design process is ongoing beyond financial memorandum getting published, as you've just shown us, and also beyond some of the initial stages of the legislation. Do you accept that that is also a problem? Because it means that we are unable to decide what the costs will be if that process of suggestions coming in about the bill is still ongoing.
I accept the premise of what you're saying. So, it's clearly in the interests of Parliament to have all the relevant information in front of them. That's why a financial memorandum is presented along with the bill's provisions. I accept that in this case, we now have information that allows us to present update that financial memorandum, and it's the earlier that we can do that, the better, to help support parliamentarians in their work.
So just from a practical angle then, as I understand it, the Justice Committee is discussing taking stage one evidence just now, is that correct?
They're starting their stage one evidence sessions, or they plan to start their stage one evidence sessions after Easter recess.
And do we know how long that stage one process will be?
We understand that they are planning sessions that run up until the end of May. We don't know for certain exactly whether that will allow stage one to be fully completed by summer recess, or whether that will extend after summer recess at the moment.
I think, convener, it would be very helpful if we could get some detail on when we might expect the revised financial memorandum.
Indeed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Liz. Michelle to follow by Ross.
Good morning. Thank you for attending. And just picking up on that last point and reiterating what my colleague Liz Smith and the convener said, I feel it would be absolutely necessary that we have an updated FM before the conclusion of stage one, and certainly before the production of any report, because there's a critical dependency in terms of the satisfaction of the Finance Committee that the numbers are within certain ranges as accurate as they can be going forward. So I would add my voice to that. It's really very important. Now, as well as the finance side, we've also got responsibility for public administration. So I must admit, I'm really quite surprised in terms of organisational culture, how we've ended up where we are. My colleague Liz Smith set the backdrop. We've seen an increasing number of framework bills. And framework bills carry significant risks to the public purse, in that a lot of the costs are put past a stage where the numbers bods, i.e. us, would be able to really look in detail at them. So from a public purse point of view, they represent a really significant risk to a waste of money. So what I wanted to ask you, what conversations are going on in your area as to the risks against the backdrop of really chronic shortages in public sector funding? What are the risks that are actively being considered of using framework bills?
So there is lots of elements in this bill. It's not just an enabling bill or a framework bill. The Code of Ethics, Duty of Candour, Section 4, there's lots of elements within, that
but
are on the face of
the point
of the
I'm making specifically is There is a risk of overspend, of inefficiency in spend, of sunk cost as a direct consequence of this co-design process. And against a backdrop of significant public sector cuts, understanding that and understanding about how money operates with these kind of programmes, that veers against the use of framework bills because they carry these significant risks. So my question is, within your kind of hierarchy and your you know, what's going on in terms of the Scottish Government, what active discussions have you had about the risks of adopting this approach in terms of inefficiency of spend?
I think it's safe to say that value for money and the public purse, impact on the public purse is a thread going through right through what we're doing within policy making at the moment. Having said that, in terms of we haven't personally, unless Steve tells me otherwise, hadn't had any personal discussions about the impact of framework legislation as opposed to detailed. We felt that this bill, working with our legal colleagues, was the best way in which we could implement the intention of the legislation through framework legislation, but we haven't specifically considered when bringing forward this bill, the impact of framework legislation in general. I can perhaps provide an answer in writing in due course to committee on that.
I mean, again, it's not part of the sort of standard process, but it sounds to me like what you're saying, that internally quite a number of departments in the Scottish Government haven't got the memo about chronic shortage of public spending. It sounds like there's, we maybe get round to think about it at some point. And in genuine honesty, if it were me, I'd be developing a detailed risk assessment of using a framework bill for this type of legislation from a purely financial perspective and disclosing all of that. Because what this plays to, and I think what you're picking up from the committee, is confidence. And if in your preparations for today, either yourselves or, whatever sort of directorate might have looked back at some of this committee's kind of deliberations around a number of different bills and gleaned very quickly and easily that we have concerns about framework bills and prepared you adequately for that, because it really is a significant concern. I mean, in terms of the actual FM itself, a lot of the points have been picked up, and your kind of opening comment, all the questions I kind of had, I thought, right, these are in effect moot. So I suppose the question then to me is just to explore a bit more, how on earth did we get here? Now, I notice and I acknowledge that you've clearly had conversations with Police Scotland, Scottish Police Federation and so on, but I am interested to understand, given those conversations, what was the nature of them if, when we got to the nub of it in terms of giving evidence, that suddenly they really had no meaning? What actually happened and why are we where we are?
Do you want to come in?
So, as we say, we have been working closely with Police Scotland, and when the bill was introduced in June last year, it was at that point that they were able to understand the full impact of the legislation on them. So one of the higher costs is on the training costs for the Code of Ethics and Duty of Candour, which we were told would be absorbed within the general training for officers.
You thought it could be absorbed based on the conversations that had taken place by that point. So why was it that the information that they had available led them to that decision? It can only logically be because there was either a lack of information given to them, leading to a lack of understanding, and as they gained more understanding, they were able to update their figures. And that plays to the point that my colleague Liz Smith is making, that actually people are making up numbers with no clue of what actually is intended by the legislation.
Yeah, I think at the heart of that matter is that there's a statutory duty on the Chief Constable to ensure that all officers have done the training. Right. And at that point, that's where there's going to have to be a training package developed, which I think...
So that statutory responsibility wasn't known prior to that? the fact that there was a statutory responsibility which brings associated costs. That wasn't known at the point of the original conversations. Is that what you're saying?
We were able to explain the policy, and we were able to say what we were including in the bill, but it's really that key point which was unknown at that point in time by Police Scotland, I don't think.
So they set out in their response to your committee that it wasn't until they saw the exact wording of the bill which said that calls on Police Scotland, they didn't know that that was the case. So whether that's we can't say exactly the wording of what will be in the bill before it comes to Parliament, but we can have proper conversations with Police Scotland and anyone else about about the policy intention. But until that was known, they didn't. I also said in relation to that they are adopting a different approach when it comes to assessment of training and IT costs across the board when they're assessing the impact on them as an organisation. So between the time where they provided information to us and the time that they provided information through the call for evidence, they have put in place more robust processes, and it's partly as a result of the pressures that they're facing as a result of the constraints on public finances that they feel they need to be better at explaining and setting out exactly the impacts on them to ensure that informs the asks that they put into Scottish Government when it comes to budget discussions.
And my last wee comment, which I suspect is probably moot, but in terms of ranges for things, I mean, I will look at a range, and the scale of the range adds to my confidence. So, in other words, if the range is significant, then that makes me less confident. A range is entirely acceptable because we realise these are estimates rather than final figures. So I did notice that the estimated cost of the bill's provisions, the kind of upper, it was 2.7 times more than the lower figure. Do you anticipate, or is it in your tension in the updated FM coming back before the end of stage one, that the ranges will be something more acceptable?
I think at this point, it's before we start, before we finalise, it's almost like the range is one of the endpoints of where we get to. So I can't commit one way or the other, but I take on board your point and take on board, we'll try to make sure that we minimise the range as much as we possibly can.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Ross, before my John.
Commissioner, just a couple of quick questions. First is on process. Graeme, you mentioned your understanding of protocol. And the protocol for the initial publication lodging of an FM is quite clear. But I think Liz Smith was right in the language that she used of the convention that has built up around this as well. And my understanding is when it comes to revision of FMs, we are generally relying more on convention. But are you aware of, were you provided with an internal Scottish Government protocol on how to revise an FM and what Parliament would require from that, i.e. including time scales?
Ask Steve to come in on that.
So there's a bill handbook that sets out process, and often the financial memorandum would get revised after stage two if there's any amendments, and that's where we assumed that would be the point that we would be able to revise the financial memorandum. However, we can look at the bill handbook and see if there's guidance there, and I'm sure there will be, on how to revise a financial memorandum or to update it in line with the guidance that's already there for the initial financial memorandum.
And I think just to back that up, we'll certainly take back the information and the evidence that you've provided to us today and look to feed that into those responsible for the overall bill handbook and see if it can be updated accordingly. It's a living document, so it gets updated on a regular basis.
That would be useful. I think it would also probably be worthwhile for us as a committee to engage directly with ministers on the handbooks. I think my understanding of the handbook is that it is not specific enough in these circumstances, and there is a clear need for revision. The other point was just I sympathise with you in that ultimately you are significantly dependent on the information provided by Police Scotland. It's unavoidable. It's not like there's third-party sources of the kind of information you need. Am I correct in understanding from what you said that the first you were aware of Police Scotland's changed position was when the evidence submitted to us was published, i.e. that they did not proactively come and contact you. At the point at which they presumably realised they got our call for evidence, they realised that what they were going to submit was significantly different to what they had originally provided to you. Did they proactively contact you to let you know, or did you find out when our evidence was published?
Just jump in first and then bring it in, and Steve. We are engaging on a regular, really regular basis with Police Scotland and or with the Professional Standards Department within Police Scotland, who are the department that are the most affected by the provisions in the bill, and are the lead department within Police Scotland. It's safe to say that as a result of the changes within Police Scotland, they're looking at it much more holistically, impacts of bill provisions across the organisation, and what those previous conversations that we'd had directly with Police Scotland, it wasn't until they've managed to do that across the organisation that they've come up with the totality of what they presented back in the call for evidence. I'll let Steve come in on the specifics of those conversations that we had.
So, yeah, they had intimated that the cost would likely be higher when the evidence was published, but until it was published, that wasn't really their official position that had been agreed, I don't think. So that's when we saw the evidence published, that was when we realised the difference.
So, sorry, I realise this is going to sound like I'm repeating the question, Sam. They didn't provide that revision to you directly. The first that you actually saw it written down as a new set of figures was when we published the evidence that was provided to us.
Yeah, that's correct.
Convener, I think we need to take that up with Police Scotland, because I can't understand why they wouldn't provide that information. There's issues here of government process, but I'm a bit disturbed that the police would know they were making a significant revision and not provide that information to the government.
Yeah, we'll obviously deliberate in our private sessions on where we go from here as a committee, but if that's your questioning finished, I'll let John in, and he'll be followed by Michael.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, maybe to slightly disagree with the convener, I have to say I do agree with your idea of materiality and rounding things to 10,000 or so. I think that's much more realistic. That's quite normal in accounting practices. So, yeah, so I think this is a good example, and the others should actually follow this example, that the idea of having very precise figures, I mean, going down to £134 or £474, you know, I just see personally as far too, well, just unrealistic, frankly. And, I mean, some of your figures clearly are rounded. SPA potential cost, £259,000. So that, I personally, and the committee may disagree with me, but I personally think that is the right way to do it. And like a figure with 134 at the end, I would just drop, because there is no way we are being that accurate. Anyone can be that accurate when you're making such forecasts. So that's just my comment, if you like, by way of support. Sticking to the materiality thing, I saw on page 9, paragraph 30, you compare the materiality of the £10,000 as a percentage of the annual budget of the different organisations, which come in at like 0.001% and such like. I just wonder, would it be better, or did you consider counting the showing the materiality as a percentage of the actual bill costs, which would therefore be, I mean, there'd be something like 2% in some cases, that kind of thing. I just wonder if that would be more helpful.
That's an interesting way of looking at it. I think what we were looking to do was to capture the costs as a percentage of the overall budget to show that it did seem to be quite absorbable and not material to the consideration of the bill.
Yes. Because given we're looking at this actual bill, I suppose for me a material figure is how it compares to what's in this bill rather than necessarily what the whole budget is. But anyway, I'll just throw that in as a point of consideration, because your percentages that are shown in paragraph 30 are tiny, and they would still be small enough if it was compared to the bill. But anyway, I'll throw that in by way of comment. The convener kind of touched on the point about the cumulative effect, that you could have a number of issues under 10,000, but together they would come to over 10,000. I mean, I just wondered again, would it be possible to have a line in paragraph 33, where you show the different costs, you know, just a kind of sundry or miscellaneous or something like that? Or are you not comfortable having a figure like that?
Yeah, I think if you look at table 3 on page 12, that's where it starts to set out what we think is the immaterial costs are the ones that would maybe transfer to another body or to be absorbed.
Right. One of which at least was an immaterial saving, was that right? So it kind of sets some of the others. Yeah. Okay. And then just a couple of questions on some of the more assumptions or details or whatever. I didn't quite understand the point that if somebody has retired, the costs would be, or have left the service, the costs might be higher in their case than if somebody's still in the police service. Can you just explain around that what happens there?
Sure, yeah. So right now, if there's allegations of gross misconduct and an officer resigns or retires, and this is gross misconduct and not any criminality, then the hearing would stop, so there would not be an outcome. And what we're looking to do in the bill is to make sure that an outcome is achieved, so that it's either not gross misconduct or it is gross misconduct. Mm-hmm. And if it is gross misconduct, then it would be put onto the barred list. And until that outcome has been reached, then it would be the person would be on the advisory list.
Right. So how do the costs vary because of that? Would the cost for either the cost for Police Scotland or the cost for the individual officer be different and would be handled differently whether they're in the service or they've left?
So the costs are the investigatory costs, and I think if an officer resigns, then the investigatory costs and the cost of the hearing would stop, whereas if the hearing was to continue, the police might need to still investigate that. If they had investigated that, then they would also have incurred the cost of the hearing as well. So those two costs would be part of the cost for the former officers.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I'm either understanding or explaining myself very well. In Police Scotland's evidence, they say the legal costs involved in defending such challenges vary but will always be significant. An example of the level of cost that can be incurred was provided by a response, and it goes on so far. But they seem to suggest that it would be different. If an officer had left, they might want their own legal representation, whereas they wouldn't if they were still within the police.
Yeah, so I think what's being referred to there is the legal costs associated with that. Which, so at the moment, if someone resigns or retires, no further action can be taken. We are looking to make sure that further action can be taken or considered. At the moment, legal costs there wouldn't be any legal costs arising from that. Mm-hmm. What Police Scotland are rightly pointing out, and the Federation have also pointed out in their evidence, is that someone will have to provide those legal costs now, which wouldn't exist, or which are a direct result of the legislation being introduced, and we accept that.
So does the Federation cover the costs of existing officers but wouldn't cover it for officers who had left? Right. And also, is there a difference between higher ranks and lower ranks as to how the costs are involved?
What we have put into the financial memorandum is based on the information that provided me as an overall cost, both legal costs and of an average cost, irrespective of rank. But it's safe to say that there's a wide range, ranging from zero legal costs up to, I think, it's in 170,000 or something like that. That's set out there, which that could be incurred as a result of there. So we have to go for an average, otherwise we would end up in a situation where we're providing a very wide range, and Michelle, taking on board Michelle Thompson's point, that we want to try and minimise that.
Can I just point out as well that the bill doesn't say that the officers would need to have that legal representation, it's just that if they wanted to have that legal representation, which they might want to in a gross misconduct case.
Right. Because one of the points the Federation makes is that it seems grossly unfair that those in higher ranks, who are also higher earners, are having their financial costs paid, yet the federated ranking officers are having to pay for their defence either personally or through their professional subscriptions. Is there an inconsistency there?
So at the moment, the Federation usually pick up the tab for all the, as a result of their
at any
membership.
Level.
Of, no, for the federated ranks. And there are other representative organisations, the Association of Police Superintendents and the Scottish Police SCPOSA for senior officers, so those are ACC and above. And as a result of the legal costs are sometimes picked up by Police Scotland for those ranks, and that's because the membership of the Federation is 97% of the or 97% of the ranks, so they can generate more in funds to allow for the spending of legal costs, where that isn't possible through at those more senior levels. So the police service itself sometimes picks up the cost.
Right, OK, that's interesting. Thank you. And finally, I think probably on page 23 of the financial memorandum, paragraph 107, it talks about PERC making recommendations to the Chief Constable, and this is under the heading unknown indirect costs, so there's a lot of uncertainty around this. So it would depend what these were. If there is a cost in implementing the recommendation, then this indirect cost cannot be quantified. I was just wondering if you could give any examples of that. I mean, what might PERC recommend? And is it really just so, the variations are so wide that you just cannot put a figure on it?
So what the bill aims to do is to strengthen the scrutiny of the police by enhancing the PERC's role. So the PERC, when it makes recommendations, the Chief Constable, to make sure that we're not interfering with the Chief Constable's operational independence, they would have to respond. So they might respond by saying that this is something that due to resourcing or due to an operation, they wouldn't want to implement. But the PERC will make those recommendations, they'll be in public, and the Chief Constable would have to respond, but we're not able to fully see what the PERC would see from their review of the Police Scotland's activities to see what they would recommend.
So, I mean, I don't know what kind of thing they would recommend, but say it was some new piece of equipment like camera or something, new cars, whatever it might be, is it just totally unpredictable then what they might recommend?
Yeah, it could be a new piece of equipment, or it could be a new training regime or something. Mm-hmm. So it's pretty unknown. But the Chief Constable would then take that on board, thinking about resources at the time as well.
Right. So even with a revised a financial memorandum, that would stay the same, basically. It would still be unpredictable.
It would still be unpredictable, yeah.
OK. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. Michael, to be followed by Jamie.
Thanks, Convener. Can I ask the witnesses, do you accept the costs as presented in the evidence from Police Scotland?
So, as I set out in my opening statement, for two of the three key elements, we accept. So that was in relation to the staff costs, additional staff costs associated with the anticipated increase for gross misconduct cases, and for the legal costs for former officers, we accept those. Where we're still in active negotiations with Police Scotland is in relation to the training costs. So the training costs associated with the introduction of the code of ethics and a strategy and a duty of candour.
And is there anything else in the evidence that we've received that you would take on board in terms of when you're trying to revise the financial memorandum?
The inflation costs and the pay, the reference to the pay increase, we would take account of, because in essence that feeds into the staff costs that I outlined earlier. So we recognise there's been pay increase since those original figures were provided.
Okay. And we've actually, as a committee, it's been referenced already, we've had a lot of back and forward with the government on financial memorandums of late. So I'm really looking for clarity from you. Do you accept that this financial memorandum is not fit for purpose as it stands?
I accept that that it is in need of revision. So I accept that the information contained with it is not up to date, and we are accepting the vast majority of what's in the evidence provided by Police Scotland and others.
Because the evidence would indicate that the costs are up to 3.5 times higher than those that you've presented so far. And it's really important for us, obviously, as my colleagues have set out, that we don't move to a stage one consideration with something that is so vastly out of kilter and doesn't have the right evidence base within it. So do you accept all of that?
I accept that it is of benefit to Parliament overall to make sure that that we update this as soon as we possibly can, in line with what I said earlier.
Did you consider, knowing that you were going to come here today and tell us this, did you consider writing to the committee and saying the information in this financial memorandum is wrong, we'll revise it and we'll come back at a later date?
We didn't, because we didn't understand that that's what you would be looking for. As we've said, irrespective of whether it is correct or not, we had the understanding that we would be coming back with a revised financial memo after stage two. It's clearly not the case, based on what we've heard today. So I accept that we need to do something different.
Thank you. And on that basis, I mean, we've heard a little bit about handbook, but I think this is not a direct, in part, criticism of your own work in this area, but this is, and you'll be getting this very strongly, this is the fourth time the committee has been in this position. Who does the training for the preparation of financial memorandums within the Scottish Government?
So Parliamentary Liaison Unit, so I couldn't remember their full name. I could only remember the acronym. The Parliamentary Liaison Unit within Scottish Government are responsible for providing ongoing training, and they hold regular sessions with members of bill teams on a wide variety of things related to the introduction of a bill, and including one specific one on financial memoranda.
And is there, you're not presented them with any standard ways of presenting these, as colleagues have picked up. You know, we're looking at wildly different ways of presenting what should be the same thing. So the convener's pointed out we can't be in the position of comparing apples and pears. You know, we've got this and little disagreement between Mr. Mason and the convener there about how these figures are presented and material or immaterial, but there's no standardised process that you're presented with to say this is how you should present these figures?
Yes, there is a standardised process. I think it was, we thought it would be helpful to try and introduce the concept of materiality, but obviously that's for the committee to decide if that's helpful or not.
So, you didn't adhere to that standardised process?
Yes, we very much did in terms of the rest of the financial memorandum, but introducing that aspect of materiality is something that is not I've not seen before.
And if you don't mind, just to back that up, I recognise that in our attempt to try to provide something that we thought would be helpful, we haven't succeeded, and certainly take your point about consistency. Like, if that is the most important thing for committee and for Parliament in general, then take the point that adhering strictly to what is in a template form and the advice that is in that handbook, we'll take that on board.
I mean, I would say that consistency is important and it's certainly useful, but I mean, accuracy is clearly the most important thing within the process, and we don't have that in this process either. Can I ask then, in just closing, convener, part of us colleagues have addressed the issue about the number of framework bills that we're receiving. And who is it in this process that is saying to you as bill teams and as civil servants what we should be doing, what we should be producing our framework bills?
I think it's being decided on a case-by-case basis. It's not a policy intention or an intention by ministers or officials to introduce framework bills. We make take into account the individual circumstances, what you want to achieve, and in this case we made decisions on what we were trying to achieve in consultation with our legal colleagues and in SGLD and PCO, Parliamentary Council Office, to develop what we're trying to do.
But there's been a very marked increase in the number of framework bills that the Parliament is looking at, from major pieces of legislation like the National Care Service, you know, this one as well. We've seen these all the time now. Whereas, you know, I'm a relatively new Member of Parliament, elected in 2021, but my understanding is that in years past, these were incredibly rare, if not completely unheard of. And now we are seeing them in this committee, you know, almost every month in the agenda that's there. So is it a fashion that's running through the civil service?
I think we can take away the point you're making as officials, but there's also potentially a question there for ministers as well. But from an official's point of view, there's no deliberate intention to do anything, or certainly not within the constructs of this bill, and certainly not anything that I've ever heard about whether we should do more or less framework bills.
Okay. And there's been no reflection within your discussions in civil service as to the clear problems that these are presenting in terms of the financial accounting of it as we are presenting as a committee, but the general ability of the public to, and the ability of the Parliament to scrutinise the legislation effectively. That's not been reflected on in the civil service.
It may well have been reflected in the civil service, but we're not party to those. So I can only go from my own personal experience.
From the bill side. Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Kabir.
Thank you very much, Michael. Jamie?
Thanks very much. I won't repeat all the points regards to framework bills that have been made, and I certainly support colleagues on those. I just wanted to ask briefly about the kind of timelines. You suggested that the Police Scotland didn't weren't aware of the implications, full financial implications of the bill, until they saw the bill presented. You suggested that, despite working closely with them, their official position didn't change until, as far as you can see, the evidence was presented to us. In that interim period since June last year when the bill was presented, what concerns have they raised with you about the costs, and what figures did they put on any potential increase on costs?
So when Police Scotland have had to assess the bill and work out what those costs are, and when we were engaging with them, they said that they think the cost would probably be higher than what they had said to us prior to introduction.
So when did they say that?
So it was raised at the Scottish Police Consultative Forum when we met there.
When is that? I'm trying to get an idea of the timeline of you know, how long it's taken to kind of get to this position we're in.
September 2023.
Okay. So in September 2023, they raised concerns over the costs. And again, at that point, did they put a figure on it, or did you go back to them and say, look, can you revise those costs now, provide us with an updated parameters effectively?
No, so we didn't know the figure until it was published with as evidence to the Finance Committee.
But did you ask them for updated costs?
We were discussing, but I don't think they were able to say precisely, and I don't know if they would know until it's been agreed as an official.
Can I just specify, this is going back to the point I made previously about the fact that we're interacting directly with the Professional Standards Department, but what Police Scotland have done since the introduction of the financial memo, the discussions at the Scottish Police Consultative Forum, and through to what they provided to committee through call for evidence, is that they have developed a corporate position, so which needs to be signed off by the executive team of the of Police Scotland as an official position. So it's taken them time. Would be my understanding, taking them time to arrive at that corporate position, where they can set out exactly the overall impact on the organisation.
But while that's been happening, obviously you've been progressing with your work and the bill. Mm. I mean, what concerns does that raise with you that I mean, were you aware that they were going to present new costs?
We were aware that they would give evidence to the committee.
So you had no idea at any point that the 5 million upper potential cost was going to be presented. So that came as a complete surprise to you?
The exact figures were a surprise to us. I think we'd anticipated that there would be some increase presented, but we didn't know the exact figures.
I mean, it just seems odd to me that you're aware that those costs are being revised. You don't know what those costs are going to be. Ultimately, they came at three and a bit times. You know, and at no point are you aware, or that there seems to be, at no point do there seem to be concerns from you how that might impact on the progress of the bill, and obviously this committee's ability to scrutinise that. I mean, the costs are going to go up hugely for a key player. I mean, do you think you've done enough in keeping in touch or liaising or requesting that information from Police Scotland?
So, you know, the information at the point in time when the bill was introduced was the best information that we could have from Police Scotland. They've now revised that, and I think that we'll use that better information that we've seen given to committee to revise the financial memorandum.
And has this, I mean, as I say, you know, you weren't aware of it. Will this change how you may look at this in the future in other cases?
I think it's safe to say that it is in our collective interest, and we're working with Police Scotland across a full range of legislation that they have an interest in, to consider the impacts on them as an organisation. They accept that they need to do better as an organisation at assessing the financial impact on them and engaging with the parliamentary process in doing so. And that includes in working with bill teams like ourselves in advance of the introduction of a bill to Parliament, and then before stage one consideration. From our perspective, I have to sit and accept the feedback that you've all provided today, that and recognise that we have not fully understood exactly the process here and the benefit of producing information in suitable enough time to allow you to give proper consideration to that.
Can I ask just then quickly, when was a decision to update the FM made?
When was the decision made? Once we'd received that call for evidence and in preparation for today.
So can you kind of remind me when that would have been?
Within the last few weeks.
Okay. So it's a relatively new decision. Okay. And I suppose looking at you've got the figures now from Police Scotland, those updated costs. You say you're negotiating or you're discussing those with them. Is the concern, given that those figures that they've presented evidence, could even increase higher?
So now Police Scotland are able to see the exact wording of the bill, that those figures should be more accurate?
I don't anticipate them increasing based on what is in the bill at the moment, and obviously that's subject to parliamentary process and could be amended, but based on what is in the bill at the moment and what they have produced to committee and the conversations that we had with them just last week, we do not anticipate that changing from their perspective. I'm trying to think of anything that might pay. Should another pay deal be agreed and negotiated with the police, then that would impact on it, but that's not imminent.
Okay, thank you.
Now you had one brief supplementary.
A brief supplement. I just wanted to pick up on the point about the training you get from the Scottish Parliament Liaison Unit. How long does that training last?
So there are, I think off the top of my head, is it eight separate sessions of an hour each, where bill teams once a year, essentially, come together. So in reality, while we've been preparing for this bill, we've been able to attend or had the ability to attend to okay. those sessions.
And so just to be clear, in terms of the bill team, how many of the bill team that have had an input to the FM have attended the entirety of that training?
Would have attended the entirety of the training.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. And is there any other kind of project management training, really? Is it just all in-house that you've articulated?
In terms of for Scottish Government officials?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. In terms of bill management and supporting bill processes, it is that work. That is the training programme that's supported by PLU.
And how many FMs have you both developed, or indeed the wider bill team? What's the sort of typical experience? Is this part and parcel of what you're doing, or is this your first encounter?
I've contributed to two or three more financial memorandum before now, but this is Steve's first financial memorandum.
And how many FMs have you undertaken for framework bills?
I don't think I've been involved in a framework, what I would classify as a framework bill. Anything can be. It depends how you define
it. It is last brief supplementary, thank you, Convener. And in terms of the effectiveness of the FM, is that something that's included in your kind of annual review? Bill teams generally, I don't mean yourself specifically. Is that something that's included, how much an FM hits the mark?
I think that's very, very much something that we'll be reflecting on in terms of future financial memorandums, to make sure that they are presented in the best information for the committee.
I think it's absolutely fair to say we will be taking what you've told us today and going back to our colleagues in wider Scottish Government to work on how we could do better.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. That's concluded questions from the committee. Just one or two from me. It seems to me that now that the Police Scotland have provided figures, you seem to have more or less accepted those. What level of interrogation of those figures has been undertaken by the bill team?
Well, there is particular... without going back over what I've already said, when it comes to training costs, we are interrogating that. The reason being that... Is the need for establishment of standalone individual training packages and the need for the different needs of probationers coming into the police service, and they get a good amount of training at the moment, and the officers and staff that have been in the organisation for a longer period of time. We need to drill down into that and work with Police Scotland to understand that. When it comes to the difference in staff costs, in some ways that's prima facie. It's reflective of the fact that there is increased costs on staffing, which Police Scotland's budget is... quite a significant part of Police Scotland's overall budget. Sir, do you want to come in?
We did some sense checking of the information that we had received by speaking to the Home Office and by speaking to the Met's office the Mayor's office, which is responsible for the Met. And as well as that, there's plans for taking forward second year legislation that could reduce costs by having things like accelerated hearings and whether the evidence is incontrovertible. So we're looking at this in the round in terms of the bill and secondary legislation.
Okay. I have to say, though, I am quite just astonished, frankly, that it seems only when this committee call for evidence went out that you realised there was a need to review the figures, and yet we still ended up with figures from September 2022. We talked about the kind of a process document being a living document, but surely up until a financial memorandum is actually presented to committee in an updated form, it should be a living document. And if you know that the figures are inaccurate, then there's a real misunderstanding of the role of this committee and the processes of this Parliament, that you actually come here with something which bears no resemblance to what the actual figures are, and indeed the timescale in which scrutiny has to take place to accept that.
I accept, based on what we've, what you've told us today, Convener, and other members of the committee, that we had personally misunderstood the role and the timing of producing a revised financial memo. We'll take on board what you're saying, and we'll do as much as we can to get that back into Parliament as quick as possible.
I mean, ultimately, this is taxpayers' money, so there is a duty to actually ensure that figures are accurate. Because what we don't want is a situation where our bill goes through, the figures are, for example, chronically underestimated, as appears to be in this case, and then that money has to come out, for example, from potentially from frontline policing services. I mean, that's what we could be talking about if it's not actually looked at. So this is why we're looking at this in such a serious way. This is important that we get this right. So I'll just end by saying that I think, speaking on behalf of the whole committee, we look forward to a revised financial memorandum prior to completion of stage one evidence, in order that we can once again scrutinise that updated financial memorandum in order to inform the lead committee. On that point, I want to thank you, gentlemen, for your evidence this morning, and I look forward to seeing you again before too long. Thank you. And I'm going to call a 5-minute break before we have a change of witnesses.
Right, folks, we're just going to kick off. The next item on our agenda today is an evidence session with the Scottish Fiscal Commission to discuss the Commission's report on fiscal sustainability perspectives, climate change, which was published on 14th of March 2024. We're joined today by Professor Graeme Roy, Chair, Professor David Ulfe, Commissioner, John Ireland, Chief Executive, and Claire Murdoch, Head of Fiscal Sustainability and Public Funding, Scottish Fiscal Commission. I welcome you all to the meeting and invite Professor Roy to make a brief opening statement. Good morning and welcome.
Good morning and thank you, Convener. Unmitigated climate change would be disastrous for society, the economy and the public finances. For this reason, and in line with the Paris Agreement, both the Scottish and UK governments are committed to help limit future global warming by reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Whilst necessary, these actions impose costs on the public sector. Our report explores how the Scottish Government's finance could be affected by aspects of climate change. There are three ways that the public finances will be affected. One, spending to repair damage from climate change because of storms, floods or droughts. Two, investment in adaptation to reduce damage from climate change. And three, action to reach net zero and limit further global warming. On the second of these, adaptation, the Climate Change Committee has estimated the economy-wide investment required across the UK is £10 billion a year between 2020 and 2030. The scale of potential investment required is large and uncertain. It is also unclear whether Scotland will need proportionally more or less investment than the rest of the UK and also the public sector's contribution. Even with investment and adaptation, there will still need to be spending in response to the first channel of potential costs, climate change damage, where there's even less information on costs. Unsurprisingly, therefore, it's not clear how costs in Scotland compare with the rest of the UK. There's more known about the third aspect, the investment needed to achieve net zero, and we focus on the likely implications in our report. We make use of estimates from the Climate Change Committee on the nature and scale of likely investment required in Scotland to reach net zero. We make assumptions about the extent of devolution and the share of public sector investment in each sector to produce our illustrative estimates of the investment required by the Scottish Government to reach net zero. On this basis, we estimate the Scottish Government needs to spend an additional £1.1 billion annually between 2020 and 2050. Now, to give an idea of the scale of that investment, that's 18% of the 2024-2025 capital budget. Now, that number requires careful interpretation. First, it's a projection based upon assumptions which we set out in the report and I'm sure we'll discuss today. It's designed to provide an indication of the likely scale of investment required. Secondly, the projection only covers mitigation. It does not cover spending on adaptation and damage from climate change, which is something we hope to cover in the future as more information becomes available. Now, providing illustrative estimates of mitigation investment, we hope to better understand the sources and scale of potential risks to the Scottish budget. Now, for example, given the way the fiscal framework works, a significant element of Scottish Government funding depends upon UK Government policy decisions and the operation of the Barnett formula. Any differences between UK Government and Scottish Government approaches to net zero could present a fiscal risk to the Scottish Government. These differences could relate to timing, the extent to which governments bear the costs themselves, or the extent to which they use regulation, tax or other incentives to encourage private sector investment. One good illustration of that we cover in the report concerns forest and land use, which is largely a devolved area of responsibility. Scotland accounts for 32% of the UK landmass, roughly half of UK trees and 70% of peatlands. The Committee on Climate Change assume meeting the Scottish and UK Government targets for net zero requires significantly more investment in forestry and land use to take place in Scotland than in the rest of the UK. This means that the fiscal burden of reaching the UK's net fiscal target may fall disproportionately on the Scottish Government. Finally, our report recommends improvements in data and information required from both governments, and this information will hopefully help a fuller assessment of the fiscal risks facing the Scottish Government in due course. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much for that and for a very interesting report, Professor Ron, a very sobering report. I should say, of course, that I'm not particularly thrilled by the introduction of the acronyms LUWCF, Land Use Change and Forestry, but it is clearly important because, as you've just pointed out, there's a disproportionate cost to Scotland as opposed to the rest of the UK. And what I find quite interesting in paragraph 21 report was that what you've pointed out is that the differential cost between Scotland and England per person per year in terms of addressing the issue of investment for mitigation is £207 in Scotland and £149 in the UK. And that's a £58 difference. But what you've pointed out is that £54 of that £58 is simply because of land use change and forestry. So do you think, I mean, given that this is quite a huge additional burden to fall on Scotland and a burden over many years, do you think, for example, that consideration should be given in terms of the devolved settlement through the block grant in order to take that into account?
So, obviously, it's not for me to comment on the fiscal framework.
I thought I'd catch you out there.
And the specifics of that. But I think the general point that we're picking up here, I think, it is really important in that the fiscal framework, the devolution and budget arrangements, weren't set in considering issues around climate change. So when you start to look at issues such as climate change and how they translate into the budget process, you actually reveal some really interesting dynamics that are going on here. And I certainly learnt a lot when we were pulling this report together. And you see the potential areas where there could be variations in the risk given the nature of the fiscal framework. So one of these is, you're right, is I call it, or LULUCF, which just is a basic thing, but the geography is different between Scotland and the rest of the UK, and therefore the opportunity and the investment that can come from tackling climate change and forestry and restoration of peatlands, that is going to be more focused on Scotland, but it's a devolved responsibility, and therefore a higher share of the burden is there. But also there's other areas as well where differences in timing between the two governments in terms of relative prioritisation will have implications in how much money would be flowing through the Barnett formula. There'd be differences potentially in policy responses. So if one government chooses to rely more on the private sector to do some of the heavy lifting rather than the public sector, again, that will have implications for all of that. So I guess the key takeaway for me in this report is that we have this fiscal framework, and once you overlay it onto something like climate change, you see some really interesting dynamics that are leading to fiscal risks flowing through to the Scottish budget.
I mean, I'm going to go through some parts, some obviously touch on your report specifically in a wee minute, but I mean, I think that what you're effectively saying there is, if we think that Scotland's got 70% of the United Kingdom's peatlands, and peat restoration is absolutely critical for tackling climate change, but it may be more difficult for Scotland to afford because it's a higher proportion of our budget than the UK's, then perhaps that aspect of the fiscal framework, climate change, has to be looked at again, or perhaps overlaid the existing fiscal framework. What's your view on that?
I think, the broad conclusion that we make at the end of all of this is that, and again, this is quite interesting in terms of learning and pulling together this sort of report, is it to fully understand the interdependencies between Scottish Government and UK Government. So the UK Government needs essentially Scotland to achieve net zero, to overachieve in net zero, in order for the UK to hit net zero. And so the UK relies on Scotland in order to meet its objective, but Scotland also relies on the UK to meet its objective, because a lot of these responsibilities are going to be in reserved areas, and the funding for that is crucial. So I think the broad conclusion I would make in all of this, about, without getting to specifics about any aspect being renegotiated, is actually, if you're looking at this objectively, the importance of actually both governments working together and looking at the solutions that are needed to get to net zero, both in Scotland and the UK, is something which, from a purely public finance point of view, is really important.
Well, I mean, you give an example for... Sorry, Professor Ulf.
I think that's why we stress in the report the idea that meeting the climate change targets is a shared endeavour between the two governments. And we mean that in two senses. One is how you actually work out the precise way which the reductions in emissions are going to take place in Scotland and the rest of the UK needs to be worked out as a shared endeavour. but secondly, the funding implications of that need to be worked out as a shared endeavour with the two governments talking to one another about the issues that Graham was referring to, the timing of actions that were taking place, the balance between the use of the public sector and the private sector, and the balance between devolved and reserved areas. All of that is an area for discussion between the two governments, and that they need to manage this as a shared endeavour by talking to one another.
Yeah, I mean, that thread of shared endeavour actually runs right through the entire document. I mean, for example, one issue is flooding. You know, the recent flooding in Angus cost £15 million to the Scottish Government through a bail-in scheme. But the UK government, they had flooding of about £10 million south of the border, so there was only a £1 million consequential. So there can be disproportion. And this, of course, can work the other way, as you've pointed out in your document as well. There could be an incident that only affects the UK, and Scotland effectively gets a ban at consequential, even though it's not actually impacted on Scotland, so there needs to be a bit more flexibility. I mean, prior to the update of the fiscal framework, there was a kind of Scottish shock, economic shock, if you like, and that was obviously removed. Do you think there should be perhaps something along the lines of a climate shock, for example, so that instead of the situation whereby the kind of example I've just given in terms of flooding is enacted that way, we'd have something a bit more climate focused?
It's a really interesting reflection, and in many ways a lot of this, the example there you're giving about flooding and the potential impacts, is very similar to the discussions that this committee would have had around the COVID pandemic, and how essentially there was nervousness and a concern that actually the amount of funding that would flow into Scotland was actually dependent upon decisions taken in the rest of the UK. So there was concerns about, you know, if there was additional spending on healthcare needed to help, or business support to support a further lockdown, that then Scotland had to wait to see what that would happen for the money to flow in. So in many ways, it's very similar to that, where you might be having these asymmetric shocks across different parts of the UK, but the funding mechanism doesn't allow for that. So you could think of ways that you could respond to that. As I said, both this could be a shock that happens in England that Scotland gets Barnett consequentials for. It could be a shock that happens in Scotland where there aren't Barnett consequentials. So are there ways that you could think about managing shocks? Are there ways you could think about adjusting, think about borrowing and savings so you can actually build up funds to potentially respond to that? I think that is, if as the scientists say, that these potential risks are going to increase and become more significant, then they become more material over time. And that's where you then potentially have to look at, are the fiscal arrangements working most effectively in that world?
Yeah, I mean, of course, you say in, for example, paragraph 6, that the Scottish Government controls most public spending on surface transport in Scotland, but many aspects of its regulation are reserved. For example, banning polluting vehicles or imposing more stringent emission standards. And you go on to say this illustrates how policy decisions at UK level are important in ensuring the Scottish Government can meet its net zero targets. But you've also got shipping and aviation as well thrown into that mix as well, and they're also reserved. So how realistic is it to expect Scotland to meet its targets without very strong cooperation from the UK government?
I think it is essential, and as I said, it's shared, as David said, it's shared between Scotland needs the UK to cooperate and work constructively in order for Scotland to meet its net zero targets, but also the UK needs Scotland to implement key policies in areas which are devolved and in many ways overachieve there in areas such as land use and forestry. And I think one of the things that's really interesting, again, that, again, I certainly learnt a lot about working in this report, is that something like net zero and climate change is quite different from most of the other policy responsibilities that we have, where it's relatively clear to define that health is devolved. And there's a debate about the funding of that, but health essentially is a devolved responsibility. But climate change, as you give an example, on transport, well, you've got Scottish Government responsible for public transport, investment in transport infrastructure, roads, rail, etc.
but a lot of the regulation around transport is a UK responsibility. So net zero, the transition to net zero on climate change is quite different from most of the other policy responsibilities that we have, where it's relatively easy to define devolved versus reserved. Here, it's all-encompassing, as you would expect, given the nature of the challenge, that it comes crashing into both devolved and reserved responsibilities, and crucially, the careful interaction between them.
But if a government, for example... Sorry, Prisov.
Sorry. I think the point I'd add to that is that when the fiscal framework was initially developed, it was done so against the background that the kinds of shocks that economies faced were the normal sort of macroeconomic shocks. We did with a different type of shock here. Now, we saw with COVID that the framework we developed did actually cope with that. To some extent, there were challenges there. But the issue is the inability of Scotland to transfer funds between years and between periods. That's the challenge that's going to arise here. Because, as you said, there will be asymmetric shocks. There might be a large flood in the rest of the UK, which generates bonnet consequentials. But there's not much the Scottish Government can do with those. Equally, there might be a huge flood in Scotland, which it doesn't have the resources coming from bonnet consequentials to deal with. So I think what we're saying in this report is, because this is a shared endeavour, the governments need to just think about how well the existing fiscal arrangements will cope with climate change types of shocks, which is, I think, the point that you were trying to get to in your question.
I mean, as has been mentioned already, I mean, you know, and it says here in paragraph 38, coordination, cooperation with the UK and Scottish Government will be required to succeed in reducing emissions. But there obviously may be different policy priorities between those two governments and different spending priorities. And ultimately, therefore, Scotland will be at the mercy of those UK decisions, will it not? If, for example, a future UK government decides this, we'd rather spend the money somewhere else.
I think, the broad point that you're getting to, I think, is right. The nature of this is that there's shared policy responsibilities. So in a broad area such as transport, where decisions in reserved areas will have an impact on Scotland, and then there's areas where reserved policies will interact with devolved policies. There's then the funding element, where whatever the UK government decide to do in equivalent devolved areas will have a Barnett consequential, and that will have an impact on Scotland. And there's also then the geographical and just the general variations that differ between Scotland and the rest of the UK. So there's really strong linkages there. I also say that it goes the other way as well in the decisions that the Scottish government takes and is taken in Scotland have a really significant impact on the UK transition to net zero as well. And that's why it's quite different from most other policy areas. I can't think of one where it's that all-encompassing, where there's that interaction between the two, which will drive the success of both Scotland and the UK achieving net zero.
And what about global decisions? Because we've got the COPs year in, year out. I know there's always an element of dismay that they don't go far enough, but what about the implications for decisions made at an international level?
Yeah, and again, so that's we have to take that largely as given, just given the relative size of Scotland there. But you're right, one of the things that we highlight is that there are uncertainties with all of this, and what we're trying to do is very much show the direction of travel and the scale of investment is needed if we're to meet our obligations. But there's uncertainties around technology, for example. So if the global economy invests really significantly in new technologies, that might reduce some of the costs there. And we talk about where there could be tailwinds and headwinds in achieving net zero. There are potential changes to just overall policy agendas that will have an impact on how the potential costs to damage and adaptation. So again, we don't go into the detail in this because there is not that much information there. But clearly, if the world doesn't make the significant reductions needed in emissions and climate, and the temperatures continue to grow at an unmitigated rate, then the potential costs to the public sector in both Scotland and the UK of damage are going to be that much higher. So again, what we try to do in this report is not get too much into that. We're not climate scientists. We benefited greatly from advice and support on that, but really just to show these are the channels through the fiscal implications can come through into the budget, and then why government needs to start to prepare and get really serious about costing through these various mechanisms.
I think definitions are also important. I mean, you've said that Scottish Government should articulate their plans the UK and Scottish Government should articulate their plans on how to achieve net zero and what level of public spending will be required. And you're going to say we recommend that spend on mitigation and adaptation be identifiable in budget documentation and outturn so that spending plans can be linked to deliver spending. But what about how do we define what is actually spent on climate mitigation? Because there's a temptation for people to say that a job is a green job when it may be somewhat more tenuous to another eye, for example. Do you think there has to be an agreement between Scotland and the UK on what exactly the language that's being used is, so that they're not talking about different things when we're actually looking at these?
I'll go first and maybe Claire want to come in on some of the detail on that. I think there's two things to separate. There's one is on things like green jobs or whether things are targeted in the environment and the like, and that's where I think the definitional bits can get a wee bit woolly. And ultimately, if we're to achieve net zero, then every job will be a green job, or the vast majority of jobs will be green jobs by the very nature. I think the bit that we think that government can do more in is being much more targeted about where there are specific interventions and spending that are explicitly designed to support the transition to net zero, or explicitly designed to help adapt to the challenges that will come from climate change. So where is the investment in decarbonisation of housing? Where is the investment in grid infrastructure? Where is investment in green public transport? That's the bit which I think, from our analysis, would actually then be really helpful and much greater clarity, I think, for us and for this committee to be able to see about where is the scale of ambition matching the targets that have been set from the government. I don't know, Claire, do you want to say a bit more about what we've done?
Yes, the main data source we've used is from the Climate Change Committee, and they have an established process for estimating what they call the additional capital investment. So that's across the UK. So to a certain extent, there is a way that you can measure this, which has been done. And what we're asking for is for the government to essentially reflect something similar in their climate change plan and in their budget documents. And I think it's nice to say things are all positive for the climate, but it's what we really need is something that's a lot more specific about whether the government is meeting those kind of level additional capital requirements which the CCC have identified. So can we, in the budget documents and in the climate change plan, actually see what is the amount of money the government is spending on specific mitigation activities to reach net zero? And at the moment, that the information isn't sufficient for us to be able to do that, which is why we've had to rely on what the Climate Change Committee have, rather than being able to look at the climate change plan.
So when the draft budget's published every year, you would hope to see something like that actually being added in future, for example, from a Scottish perspective.
I mean, I think if you want to track it over time, if you want to actually, the climate change plans had set it out for 15 years, and then in the budget you should be able to see whether the government is actually spending what it's committed to spending. And the same in outturn data as well, because we all know that what's in the budget isn't necessarily what's actually spent over the year.
The climate change plan the government produces, I think, should be produced every 5 years, and that plan in the past has had a list of policies and proposals attached to which there ought to be a mitigation figure, so you can see the impact on Scottish emissions. And what we're asking for is attached to that sort of each of those policies and proposals is also a cost, ideally split down in terms of the public and private sector, but certainly a total cost. And in a sense, that's just a step forward. It's consistent with how the UK government approaches its carbon budget as well. So ideally, you'd be able to sort of have a common framework there. The other piece of information which Claire has sort of mentioned is that every year there's an annex in the budget documentation which talks about the government's climate change expenditure. And that's a very broad definition. They just categorise into sort of, basically all items of spend, whether they're sort of, you know, negative, positive, strong negative, strongly positive for climate or stroke environment. And that's not really tied in at all to the climate change plan. And what we're asking is that very explicitly that document is, or that annex is tied into the climate change plan. The previous parliamentary committees, when the government had produced its climate change plans, have asked for a proper evaluation framework, and that would be another mechanism for doing that. But the key really is to take the climate change plan that the government is committed to producing, or is required to produce, making sure that's got the right information in, and then carrying that over into the budget documentation.
To a net zero, you know, portfolio within the draft budget, but we don't really have anything in the other portfolio sections which actually specifically look at climate mitigation. But I mean, one thing, John, that you talked about there was public and private sector, and I mean, quite interestingly, you know, in terms of your figure 3.3 on page 33 of your document, if you look at, for example, electricity supply, you know, about 30% of the total cost of actually capital investment required to on the balanced pathway from 2020 to 2050 is in private sector electricity supply. You know, I mean, 20 times more than public sector electricity supply, and that's so that's not only 30% of the total cost, it's also reserved, so that shows the difference, again, the interaction. I think that graph's quite interesting because if we actually look at the devolved sectors total, more than almost half in Scotland is of the devolved sectors are public sector, but less than one tenth of the reserved sectors. So does that make you think that the public sector in Scotland has to take a greater lead, perhaps, than it is at the moment?
To say that when we were doing this split between the public sector and the private sector, we were just using the split that was used by the OBR when they did their fiscal sustainability reports. So we didn't want to introduce a further complication in our analysis by using a different definition of public sector versus private sector from the OBR. So we just followed their splits when constructing our figures here.
But I think the general principle, I think, again, is really quite interesting in the broader point, in that the nature of the sectors that are devolved are sectors that are more likely to have more heavy lifting from the public sector. And that as David said, we're using exactly the same ratios that you would have for in England, for example. So buildings, land use, surface transport, waste, agriculture, these are largely devolved sectors. But actually look at what the OBR and others have looked at, is that actually in general they're likely to be sectors that are going to rely more on the public sector to take more of a lead in there. In contrast, things like electricity supply, given the nature of electricity, given the large consumer market, that's much more likely to be done, the capital investment done by your big utilities companies. We all pay for it, of course, through our bills. Right, but it's the private sector that is largely doing that investment. And again, I think what's really interesting about the report is that it's only when you start to sit down and think and work through these, you realise that a lot of the sectors that are devolved are sectors where there's going to be the onus is on the public sector doing quite a lot of the investment into that.
Yes, indeed. It's 43% public share in Scotland, so it's quite a lot. Talking about 43%, just the last question for me, because colleagues want to come in, is regarding the offshore energy industry, because 43% of UK oil and gas jobs are located in Scotland. Mm-hmm. So what challenges does that present in terms of moving to a just transition and net zero?
Yeah. So we've discussed this much more in the context of our economic forecast in the CEF, and we will we'll expand a wee bit more on this in the upcoming forecast in May. And so the story is there, of course, is that Scotland has huge potential in the green economy, in renewables, offshore renewables, to grow new sectors, grow new jobs, grow new investment. And the key is transitioning from the energy sector that we have at the moment in oil and gas into these new opportunities. And the the opportunity there is to use the legacy and the assets and the skills that we have to create greater market share, to punch above our weight in these new sectors and industries of the future. And that's where the prize is for Scotland's economy. The risk and the challenge in there is, how do you do that? It's easy to say that, but how do you do that? How do you manage to continue to support that transition for these high-value jobs? And you've seen from our forecasts that we've done in the past, particularly in not the most recent figures, but beyond that, the gap that was opening up between Scottish and UK earnings, a large part of that was being explained by what was happening in the North East, and a large part of that was therefore explaining about what was happening in oil and gas. So from a purely, again, from economic short-term reason and from a tax reason, then that managing that transition is a risk for Scotland's economy, given their disproportionate weight on oil and gas jobs and, crucially, high-paying oil and gas jobs. And that's the big adjustment, the big transition that needs to be managed carefully.
Yeah, you've said that it's 1 in 200 jobs in the UK, 1 in every 30 in Scotland, but what share of taxation comes from that sector?
It's difficult to get the exact numbers, in part because what we can get is, we can get data by region. So we can get, we've published in the past, North East region and Glasgow and the like, and we can get that from the HMRC data. Where it's more difficult is to work out where actually many people might be working in that sector, but they locate somewhere else. So, as you know, income tax is collected in residence rather than employer. But lots of people who work in the oil and gas industry, you know, live outside the North East, live outside Scotland. And so therefore difficult to get the exact estimate in there. That's why we tend to use the North East as an example, just to give a signal of whether the sector is dragging on Scottish tax receipts or whether it's adding to it.
Proportionate.
Yes, so, yeah, it would be, yeah, of course. Yeah. And you look at average wages in oil and gas, and it's way above the national average. So if Scotland has a disproportionate number of these jobs, and it therefore matters for the income tax revenues that we're collecting.
Okay, thank you. We're going to open up the session, and first person to ask questions will be Ross, to be followed by John.
Convener, I'm interested in what I think is a bit of a contrast between your report and the CCC's report last week, where I think you've got the balance better. And I acknowledge what you said about having worked with them, but the CCC report, whilst I agree with the kind of broad criticism that we're off track, they were really quite critical of the Scottish Government for highlighting the impact of UK government policymaking, particularly financial policymaking, on Scotland's ability to meet its own targets. But as you've outlined this morning and what's in your report, you point out that we require a disproportionate amount of spend. The fiscal framework doesn't take that into account. The devolution of these powers is not uniform. CCC made some pretty sweeping comments about, you know, transport's devolved, land use is devolved, decarbonising buildings is devolved. Am I right, though, and this is maybe just a reframing of some of the convener's initial questions, is it fair for me to conclude that what you're saying is, as it stands, it is effectively impossible for Scotland to meet its own climate targets and therefore for the UK to meet its targets, given how critical Scotland's are, without either a significant devolution of financial powers to the Scottish Government, an adjustment of the fiscal framework, more direct funding from the UK government, something that is entirely within the gift of the UK government needs to change here? Because it's one thing to say governments need to cooperate, but these aren't two equal partners who have an equal amount to contribute. What you're really saying is something needs to change at UK level, whether it's devolution of powers, increased block grant, something.
I wouldn't say that. You probably expect me to say that. I think what we do in our report is simply set out where the interlinkages are and where there's potentially read across there. Again, ultimately it's a choice as well, I would say. So government can choose to make more progress on buildings. They can choose to make more progress on in transport. And again, Committee on Climate Change makes a judgment that we don't make about whether the government is making progress on that or not. But ultimately, it's a choice for government. And I guess what we're trying to do here is just highlight where, first of all, the scale of investment that's needed by essentially the public sector overall. And then secondly, highlighting where there are potential areas where Scotland might need to make more investment relative to the rest of the UK. The one thing I would say is on things like the target to get to the UK 2050 and Scotland to get to 2045, in order for the UK to get to net zero by 2050, then Scotland has to meet its 2045 target as well. So Scotland has to, you know, in many ways Scotland's committed to doing more heavy lifting, and the government have set that out. And with that comes additional investment and additional cost that has to go into all of that.
Can I just add to that?
Yeah. I think that we're saying two things in the report. One is that because of the limited ability to transfer funds between periods, it matters a great deal to Scotland both when the UK government makes certain decisions, how it splits those between devolved and reserved areas, and also how it splits those decisions between the public sector and the private sector, because all of those decisions set the fiscal context within which Scotland has to make its decisions. And then the second thing we're saying is we're just trying to illustrate the scale of some of the investment that might be required by the Scottish Government. So within that context, that will tell you how it has to balance that off against other priorities that the Scottish Government has got. I think those are the two main things we're trying to say in this report.
So you mentioned, Professor Oaf, there that split of public-private. I'm interested in what you said a moment ago, but the report makes presumptions essentially to mirror the OBR's presumptions about this is based on if it was entirely public spending. I would be keen to press you a bit on the logic behind that, though, particularly if we're taking land use, etc., LULUCF, to use your pronunciation of the acronym. The Scottish Government's already started some quite significant pilot work in private financing around nature. Now, there's a significant political debate to be had around that. I believe the Net Zero Committee are having that right now upstairs. But I'm interested in why your report makes the assumption of, particularly in land use, etc., of this being entirely publicly funded when we've already, I think it's a £2 billion pilot that's already taken place. It's not small fry what's already happening there.
So the honest answer to that and the short answer to that is that what we wanted to do was be really transparent and really simplistic, because this gets really complicated really quickly.
Yeah.
And part of it was to really highlight and say, look, actually, this is a big issue, and this is potentially a big issue in that given Scotland's geography, given Scotland's share of forestry and the potential value for Scotland in this is actually a big issue for us to discuss. So you're right, we follow the OBR and we say 100% public share, but in no way are we saying this is exactly what is going to happen, and most importantly, we're not saying this is what should happen. What we're saying is that if this, you know, if it's 100% public share, potential investment, this is the additional investment needs to go in Scotland. Now, it's then hopefully what we're trying to do is then pass it over to for exactly those sorts of conversations about, well, how do you do this? What's the best way of doing this? Can you secure private investment into this that would potentially reduce that public sector share? What would that look like? How could it be part of the process? And then how quickly could it happen, and what's the nature of all of that? So I think you're probing exactly the right things. Again, we set this out really transparently, and you can start to play around with these numbers and you'll get something different. The key point I would come back to is that the level of investment is significant, and government need to actually, you know, really set out the detail about how we're actually going to secure that level of investment, either from the public sector or from potential innovative ways to secure investment in the private sector too. And you could do that with all of them, where we've put in assumptions. You can play around with the different assumptions that go there.
If I could just add as well, in figure 3.8, we look at the LULUCF category and show as a very simplistic illustration, but if actually you only had 60% of that funded by public sector investment, you're still looking at a big gap to what would be spent per person in the rest of the UK. And so we could have made a different assumption in that category, but actually the broad principle of you've got such a big difference here in what needs to be invested that you'd need a much bigger private share to bring it down to be comparable. So in that sense, what we want to do is highlight the fiscal risk that will occur, even if you had some tweaks in how you actually deliver that to the private sector as well.
Thanks. I suppose, final point, I recognise this is to some extent repeating myself. I'm interested in the conversations that you have with the UK CCC, though, because, again, as much as I think last week's report was incredibly valuable and I agree with it as a reflection of the last 25 years and a complete failure to meet the demands that the science has set out, it left me with a lot of frustration because we need to triple the amount that we spend on peatland restoration. I mean, you know that there's not 40 million of capital money just rattling around. That would need to come from somewhere. But if you take decarbonising buildings, it's not tens of millions, it's tens of billions that we're talking about there. It's entirely unrealistic, isn't it, to expect the Scottish Government within the current envelope available to within the current confines of the fiscal framework to actually deliver the particularly capital investment required to meet the demands of both our Climate Act but the UK Government's climate commitments?
So again, I think I don't disagree with the general point that what we're trying to say here is this is huge investment that needs to be made into the Scottish budget, and we gave the number of 18% of the capital budget being a good illustration of that. And that really poses, you know, tough challenges on government. What I would say, though, is that I think what our report, I would say you have to read it alongside the Committee on Climate Change report, but also what the OBR are saying about the UK as well. And I think you have to read all three reports together that, yes, while the Committee on Climate Change are pushing Scottish Government, and we are pushing the Scottish Government for greater clarity around this, you have the OBR saying exactly very similar things about the UK, and there's a number in there that they have which is really stark about if we don't meet, if we have unmitigated climate change, you know, debt will explode to nearly 300% of our economy. That's, you know, it's completely disastrous from a purely public finance point of view, not to mention everything else that happens to the economy and society. So I think that, to be fair, I think you have to read our report alongside what the OBR are saying about the UK and what the Committee on Climate Change are saying, not just about Scotland, but also about the UK. And that's where I think the broad conclusion is, from a public finance point of view, this is a significant fiscal risk for government that requires huge investment across a whole variety of diverse areas. And that becomes even more complicated when you look at it in a devolved context. So I think that when you look at it in the round, I think you probably get a slightly different, I think you get a slightly broader view than maybe a more, this is critical specifically of the Scottish Government.
Thank you.
Yes, look, when we say this equates to something like 18% of the capital budget, we want that to be understood against the context in which the capital funding is going to be falling in real terms, at least over the next five years. And that is largely driven by decisions by the UK government to cut capital funding. So it's against that background that some of these figures need to be understood.
Yeah, and it comes back to the point Professor Roy was making about choices, but choices facing government. We can't not build new hospitals. We do. The cost of decarbonising hospitals actually is massive, but it's the challenge of how do you balance the long-term unavoidable necessity of tackling this with keeping everybody alive in the interim by meeting all the other needs of society. That's all from me, though, Convener.
Thank you very much. John?
Thanks, Convener. I mean, just to pursue this, and I have to confess this is not my area of expertise, so perhaps I'm not understanding some of the things. On land use, I get the point that we've got 32% of the UK land mass. Do these figures, because they are dramatic, that we should be spending so much more per head than the UK is, do they take into account the state of the land as it currently is? Because presumably some land needs work done on it and some land doesn't.
Yeah, I'll give you the, you know, Claire maybe come into and specifically detail that, but broadly speaking, the way to think about this, what the Committee on Climate Change have done is looked at what's the total additional economy-wide investment needed in different sectors in order to get to net zero, and that's what we take. So we start with that. So that will include all the stuff you're talking about restoration of peatland, the investment that has to go into that, around forestry, the types of trees, the preparing the land, etc. That's all in there. What we then do is then say, okay, well, how much of that is likely to be public-private split? And then we look at the potential fiscal consequences for that. So this is quite different, say, from timber production and things like that. This is purely about exactly all of those issues that go into the investment of preparing land for forestry to help soak up some CO2 emissions, and also the investment in peatlands as well. Don't know, do you want to expand on some of the detail?
Yeah, I mean, essentially the Climate Change Committee have sort of four main areas where the costs arise, and some of that's changing the use of land to forestry. A lot of planting new woodland, improving tree density, there's restoring peatland to stop them releasing emissions, and also the planting of bioenergy crops to replace fossil fuels. So those are the main categories which the CCC have looked at and estimated the share of the costs which would need to fall in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK. Okay.
So if you take forestry, I mean, I think we have been planting more trees than elsewhere in the UK, but in a sense that's not enough. Because the potential for trees in Scotland presumably is huge and is bigger than in the rest of the UK.
Yeah.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Now, you talked about the three, damage, adaptation and mitigation, and thinking especially of adaptation, you've also said that you're needing more plans, costs and data. I mean, are we in a space where it doesn't matter how much data you've got, it's still very uncertain where we're going, and you know, can there ever be enough data to give us solid projections?
So two things I would say. So first of all, there will always be uncertainty around this, and that's actually one of the big fiscal risks that we highlight. This is uncertain, and actually we need to prepare for that uncertainty, and governments are going to have to manage budgets in a world of uncertainty, particularly looking forward to some of the costs, because that's where the greatest risks are, particularly around damage as well. We've talked about that already with the convener, where you have asymmetric shocks. By definition, they're uncertain, and therefore government will have to think about how they plan for all of that in time. I think where we can make a lot more progress is there's very little information provided at all in detail by Scottish Government on likely investments in adaptation, and John was talking about the climate change plan, where you can start to cost some of these out. Government can make more progress and be more transparent around thinking about where some of the investments in adaptation are going to be, and start to give more of an indication. So I think there's my answer is probably two parts. One is, yes, more data is going to be really valuable and help get some more clarity on it. But there will always be uncertainty, and that in itself is something that the government have to plan for.
Professor?
For that, the one advantage of mitigation as against damage is that you can, in principle, plan ahead and decide what adaptation. You can, in principle, plan ahead and decide what kinds of investments you're going to be making in adaptation. The problem with damage is you might just get a storm one particular year, and there's no way you can anticipate that when that's going to occur. The real uncertainty around adaptation is we don't know how rapidly the climate's going to heat up. And the scale of adaptation might have to be adjusted in the future once you learn what other countries are doing, and therefore the potential scale of adaptation you need to be making here. So there is uncertainty around adaptation, but it's an uncertainty that you can do some planning for. And the problem we face at the moment is we just know almost nothing about what the Scottish Government's plans are to enable us to put any kind of figure on the likely scale of investment.
So should we be expecting more of that plan when we get the medium-term financial strategy later this year?
I'm not quite sure when we'll get enough information from the Scottish Government.
I mean, would that be part of that, or is that a completely separate thing?
So the government's currently got a draft Scottish National Adaptation Plan. So it would be when they, you know, one of the things that we can ask for is when they publish that final plan, that it has costings in it. At the moment, it has some rough costings on some policies, but not a sort of comprehensive estimate of what the policies that it has in its plan will cost overall and when those costs will be incurred.
Right. And what kind of timescale are we talking about for that? Do we know?
It will be published in its final form in this September 2024.
Right. So the government's committed to that. Right. Okay.
I think there's two parts to it I think would be really helpful for the broader debate on public finances and the work of this committee. There's specifics that go into a budget, which are looking at what's the next 5 years or more often than not the next year and understand the detail in that. But then there's a broader work, which is actually what's the fiscal sustainability stuff, and that's the much around the pre-budget scrutiny and the looking ahead about where the big investments are coming. And that's the bit where I think that more information in something like the adaptation plan can then inform that broader thinking about, well, here is, this is the totality of the capital budget. How much of that is going to have to go in over the next 5 to 10 years into adaptation, into mitigation, and then back to Mr. Greer's point, what's left then for everything else, and how do you make those? How do you make those choices?
Okay, I mean, maybe you could just clarify for me. One of the phrases that's used a few times is balanced pathway scenario, which again, I'm sure everybody else understands, but I didn't really know. Can you clarify what balanced pathway scenario is? I think that's a CCC term, is it?
Yeah, it is. Yeah. So there's broadly speaking, they have five scenarios. The one we use is the balanced. Then they have ones where you've got differences in terms of behavioural change and levels of investment. Do you want to maybe Claire explain the technical detail behind that?
So it's based on the UK's sixth carbon budget, so it's about what the UK needs to do over the next few years, and then to get to 2050, what the level of investments that's required each year. And to use a slightly simpler term, it's essentially their central scenario of how that's achieved, that the UK reaches net zero by 2050. And what the CCC do is look across the different sectors and where does the investment need to happen when to hit all these interim targets at the UK level as well, and how is that investment best traded off between sectors at different points in time. So we've taken those cost estimates. They produce them for the UK and they produce them for Scotland as well. So we use the Scottish figures to estimate the Scottish government's costs.
Right. Thank you. Now, this figure of the public share of investment in buildings is 43%. I think the convener kind of touched on that. I'm not sure I'm quite understanding that either. So that 43%, is that quite a kind of rough figure as to what the public sector commitment would be?
So it's an illustration based upon differences in split between different types of building. And again, as we take that from the OBR in terms of the relative balance between public and private sector. And again, you can start to play around with the different shares, for example, so you can think about more private investment, more public investment. But what we use it for is simply to say, if the total investment is £36 billion, what might be the relative public sector share within all of that? And what's crucial, of course, is how that then leads into the funding that potentially flows into that. Because remember, we use exactly the same share for the rest of the UK, so potentially the same public sector investment that goes into that would then flow through in terms of funding to Scotland.
So it's not based on ownership, it's based on an estimate of where the expenditure would come from.
So it's an average share across the residential and non-residential sectors. So there's things like in the public sector, non-residential, we assume 100% of the costs are paid by the public sector, and then obviously the private sector is bearing more of the costs for non-residential private buildings. And then in the residential sector, there's a sort of share that's there, which is for the public sector, will pay some of the costs. You know, the OBR highlight things such as lower income households, you'd expect the public sector to pick up more of the costs, whereas high income households would pay the costs of decarbonisation themselves.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering, because a lot of private owners would not be able to afford very much investment. That's fine. And I think my final point was, I mean, a lot of this is looking at additional investment, but of course we're already spending quite a lot on agriculture, the kind of replacement for the common agricultural policy. How does that interact here? Is that a factor? Because that's money that's already going out, but we can tweak it a bit as to how it's used.
The easiest way to think about it is that what we're doing is looking at the additional investment in the economy that the economy needs to make between 2020 and 2050 in order to hit net zero. Some of that is additional investment, so some of that will be new investment, but other aspects of that could be changing investment that was already in place, but actually for targeting mitigation. So some of that could be about, if you're spending money on public transport, is all of that public transport that's going to get you towards net zero? Again, that would be additional investment in public transport and net zero, but you're cutting investment elsewhere. So it's not looking at kind of the budget and saying this is raw additional investment. It's looking at what's the totality of the investment in the economy needed to get to net zero. So there'll be some things that will net off.
Okay, that's very helpful. Thank you. Convener. Sorry, yes.
So what the Committee on Climate Change do is they say, here's the level of emissions in 2020. If we're going to get to zero net emissions by 2050, how much do emissions have to fall year on year on year between 2020 and 2050? And what they're calculating is the additional investment to get that additional reduction in emissions year on year on year. That's the figure that lies behind us. We fully accept that within the figure for 2020, there's already a significant spend to get those emissions down to that level compared to their 1990 level. So we've already brought emissions down a fair bit.
So they're really looking at what spend is needed rather than where it comes from.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. To be followed by Liz.
Good morning. Firstly, can I put on the record my thanks for doing this report. I think it really, really fills a gap, and I think everyone should read it and understand it. And I'm heartened to see you're doing the session for MSPs tomorrow. And I'd like to see further iterations of it because I think it's so helpful. And I think also the CCC should also be reading it because it gives much more insight into the complexity of the fiscal framework with this level of granularity. Will you be having meetings with the Scottish Government as well about it? It's my view that I hope they will because it's so valuable.
Yeah. So as always, the government, we've engaged really constructively with the government who've helped inform work. Ultimately, this is our report, but you know, the conversation with the civil servants has always been really helpful in this. And even just chatting through with them the results and finding, as I learnt a lot doing this work with the team. And I know from the conversations with them, it was that they found it really helpful as well. So I think, again, the broader point is that I think, and thank you very much for your kind words about this report. I think part of this is going to be trying to socialise this as much as possible with a broad and diverse group, and that will be, you know, key public bodies and key stakeholders like the government, like the Committee for Climate Change too.
Yeah, and it's almost like we wish that we'd had that before there was a review, recent review of the fiscal framework, given what it sets out, wouldn't that have been very, very valuable, I think?
I think, yeah, I think one of the things that I come back to the earlier points about the convener is that I certainly hadn't thought about how this all interacts in the detail in the transition to net zero, about what does that mean in a public, you know, in a devolved context. And the broader point is that I think a lot of this work around fiscal sustainability in a devolved context hasn't been done. I mean, I think David and I have been chatting about this. There are some examples in Canada, for example, where they looked at fiscal sustainability within a devolved context, but no one's really thought about this in any great detail. So a lot of this is really new, and it's only when you start to dive into something like demographics that we did last year or climate change this year that you actually see wrinkles and lumps and bumps that otherwise you wouldn't have thought as being important. And again, I think that's hopefully where this work is designed for the long term. So it's designed to help, you know, this government think about what it needs to do. It's designed to help the government after this government to think about what it needs to do. And in time, that should get into debates about what's the optimal structure of the public finances.
And it does lead on to the perennial challenge that always comes up with this committee is about a much more strategic long-range look at public sector finance. It often expresses a need for multi-year funding. Do you anticipate that you'll have any discussions with the UK government, given the critical dependencies that you set out, you know, one needs the other? Do you anticipate you'll be able to have discussions with them or indeed Treasury?
Yeah. So again, it's not our job to influence them in any way, but we speak to the UK government, so we'll present our results and findings as we always do after a budget or after a report such as this. And they're always really engaged and really keen to learn insights, and ultimately it's up to them and their ministers to decide what to do in all of this. But this is really new, and I think, you know, I think it does add a lot to the debate and understanding of all of this. And as I said, what struck me from this is that this is so different from most of the other policy areas we talk about, where health is devolved and fuel duty is reserved, but actually if you look at the broad context around net zero and climate change, it comes crashing across devolved and reserved responsibilities in a way which is much more complex than any other area that we've looked at.
Yeah. And you alluded earlier to the kind of, you know, the normal or one with working with at the moment debt to GDP ratio of 90% and the startling figure if it was all public 289%.
Yeah.
And I think that more than anything, I know that was the OBR, makes clear the need for private investment as well. But does your report accentuate the fact that it's the volatility in the public sector funding environment will have a direct influence on the confidence of private sector funding to come to the fore as well? Am I correct in that assumption?
Yeah, in the broader concept, yes. I mean, one point that we haven't made now, it's important to get on the record, is that we assume that doing nothing on climate change is much worse in the public finances than doing something. So we almost kind of, we park that, we say this is completely unthinkable, so this is we're going to look at actually making progress on there. And that, but it's really important to remember that this isn't this looks quite challenging, let's just not do it, because the consequences of the public finances and broader economy, society are much worse. I think the broader point you're getting into here, I think, is then what do you do with all of this? So you see the relative scale of the public sector investment in there, the relative importance of the public sector. So how does government think not just about using its spend, but its role as a leader and enabler to unlock private investment and capital investment? And Mr. Greer's point about you know looking at land use and forestry, it's a significant chunky investment that needs to take place. If you assume that all of that is the public sector, then that is going to have really tough choices about what the public sector spends its money on. So if you can think about how you can get innovative funding coming in, whether that be the public sector putting in an amount of money and then leveraging in private sector investment, then that is an option. Now, clearly, there's a political debate to be had in here, but again, hopefully these numbers show that there's a political debate. There's also a public finance debate as well that needs to be balanced between, if you can secure private investment into some of these areas, that's more public investment that can go in other areas. And if you don't, then that is going to be less public investment going into other areas.
And I think you kind of make my point for me when we look at the lack of longer term range thinking. If you look at the Scottish Government set up Scottish National Investment Bank, for example, using financial transactions, and we've seen this year the change to financial transactions and their ultimate withdrawal, the ability of the Scottish Government to have sufficient long range to be able to match or attract and use leverage for public sector funding is quite diminished without that longer term range. And I think your report makes that quite starkly clear, not least of all the reminder about you can't carry forward across years.
Yeah, and there's a broader point I would add to that as well about, so we've just started doing these fiscal sustainability reports. And I've been really encouraged by the way that this committee's been really engaged with it and supported us in this work and doing it. It's really important that government and the broader parliament engage as well. So debate issues such as this and work through it, that government responds in a way which is actually taking the principles that we're trying to set out and actually have that much more forward planning. And note the comments that you had, I think, in the pre-budget report that you did about the government needing to respond in detail to these fiscal sustainability reports, like the Parliament needing to have a full debate on the fiscal sustainability. And I think that can only be healthy if we can at least discuss through these issues. So, yeah, there's the technical issues about within the budget, but there's a much broader conversation we need to have about the scale of these numbers and what and how do we respond.
Couldn't agree more.
But also, I think either this committee or some other committee needs to start getting evidence about what might be the potential blockages to getting private sector investment, what's working well, what's not working well in this area. So gathering evidence from people who are actually in the sector as to what the challenges are that they face in making this investment.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
Thank you. List to be followed by Michael.
Just one question from me, and it's one of clarification. Professor Roy, you raised an interesting point about future Scottish budgets, and it would be helpful if we can see the numbers about how much has been spent to mitigate climate change. Was your suggestion that within each portfolio of the existing budget that should be done, or are you suggesting that there should be another section within the Scottish budget where that is a cumulative total?
It's a good point. So I probably don't have a specific view on it. As long as it's really transparent, I think that would be the thing that would be useful. So whether that's within portfolios, the specific line that shows exactly whether, or whether that's all collected somewhere else, I'm kind of less worried about how it's presented. I think the key thing is it transparent? Is it really visible? And crucially, is it consistent over time? Because that's the fun that we all usually have is changing definitions and portfolios, etc. So that would be my only plea, is that it's quite transparent and it stays and it lasts the test of time.
Thank you.
What's really, really important here is to take the climate change plan the government publishes, the policies and proposals in that and their granular detail, and track those through time. Whether that's done in the budget document, as Graham, as you suggested, or whether it's done in a sort of an annual evaluation report that the government publishes, it's less important, but what matters is that that climate change plan, the detail in that is reported back on through time, so we know how each line is moving in terms of the investment the government's making.
That's very helpful, Mr. Ireland. I'm just asking the question because, as you know, there have been quite a few situations where we've been questioning just how easy is it to track money through the Scottish budget, and just from your expertise, whether it's better in one unit or whether it's better through the system. Thank you anyway.
Thank you, Michael.
Thanks, Convener. Thanks to the witnesses for the really useful discussion so far. Given all that you've said and the contents of the report, do you still believe that the 2030 target is credible?
That, again, just we don't comment on that. And we don't, again, what we're trying to do is look at the public finance elements of it. So we take the projections and we push it through. I should say that because we're using the balance pathway doesn't have Scotland meeting the 2030 target. So actually these numbers are underpinned by Scotland not meeting the 2030 target. What we then highlight is to say that if you were to try and make the 2030 target, then that require more investment. And it require more investment not just in the sense of accelerating and making up for lost ground, but it would also require more expensive investment, because again the nature of these projections have certain technologies embedded into it, so you need to make more investment there. And then secondly, because reserved policies wouldn't be making it, because we're assuming they're constant, you'd have to overcompensate for that. So I guess to answer your question without answering your question, we don't have it. We don't have these projections. Are not Scotland meeting the 2030 target? If it wanted to try and meet the 2030 target, it would need more investment than what we set out here.
Our report, we say that on the balanced pathway, Scotland will meet its 2030 target of a 75% reduction in 2035. Now, by 2035. Scotland on the balanced pathway will have spent £6 billion between 2020 and 2030, a further £6 billion between 2030 and 2035. So that means the annual average spending is going up from just over £600 million a year in the 2020 to 2030. It's doubling to £1.2 billion between 2030 and 2035. Because it's getting progressively harder to bring the emissions down to meet the target. But as Graham said, if you were trying to meet the 2030 target, you wouldn't have to spend £12 billion by 2030. You'd have to spend considerably more than £12 billion by 2030, because you wouldn't get the benefits of technical progress, which are bringing forward better ways of meeting your emissions target, and also you wouldn't get the reserved areas. You have to do it all through devolved spending. So devolved spending would have to go up by more than £12 billion to meet the target by 2030. Now, we're not saying that that's impossible. We're just saying that's the scale of the financial challenge that Scotland would face.
So that point you make, where you say in the report, you would require technologies and other changes to be more advanced than set out in any of the CCC's pathway scenarios to reach net zero. So just for clarity, what you're saying is that those technologies are not sufficiently advanced, and as a result of that, it's going to cost more money to do things on existing technologies.
Yep.
Actually, that acceleration, there's a cost to the acceleration. That's very useful. And can I ask in the broad how this maps onto your other work as the SFC? So you've set out the long-term fiscal scenarios for Scotland. Is that you've said that you've learned a lot, Professor Roy, in this process? Can we expect very substantial updates against your longer term challenges in the next iteration of your kind of 2050 vision?
Yeah. So what we're trying to do is a couple of things. One is that every second year we'll publish a much more detailed long term projection. For the moment, that's still largely based around demographics. For next year, we're doing a bit more about health inequalities and public health and putting that into there. And that's largely because we know a lot more about that. There's a lot more data in there. What we're then going to do in every other year is to do this sort of thing, which is more a perspective thing, where we take a step back and we say, actually, let's think about something like climate change. What could the fiscal risks be? But we don't have enough data, we don't have enough information that we could then start to plug them into our more detailed long-term projections. So what we're doing with this report is really highlighting the big issues. Now, in time, hopefully, as we get more information and more detail, then we'll be able to start to pull this together into a much more detailed long-term projection piece. But for the moment, we're going to be riding these two horses to an extent between highlighting issues and then also doing these long-term projections. We will necessarily be focused on a smaller set of issues.
And just in closing, I think the observations around the interoperability and the reliance on a collaborative approach between the UK government and the Scottish government, not least in the kind of the fiscal trajectory that the country takes to meet these challenges, is absolutely right. But do you feel that there are the institutions outside the fiscal framework that are reflecting these concerns? Do you think that ministers and senior civil servants are having these discussions about the scale of the challenge and where that might be met around between the devolved institutions and Whitehall?
So I probably can't comment really, to be honest, in detail, largely because we've just published this report. But I would hope that this sort of thing and highlighting some of these issues, these interactions about issues around targets, about responsibilities, about funding elements, etc. I hope it does inform these conversations and discussions. And back to the point, you know, thinking about, I think you have to look at this report alongside the Committee on Climate Change report and also what the OBR are saying at the UK. And it's when you look at all of these together, you can actually see the key message, which is the scale of the challenge, but also the urgency, but the need for planning and cooperation. And if this report can help that planning and cooperation, then be delighted with that.
Thank you.
Thank you. That appears to have concluded questions from the committee. It's quite interesting, the huge amount of money that this is going to cost, given that Scotland produces 0.1% of the world's emissions and oil production is currently 108.6 million barrels per day. So I think it's a real global issue and we can but play a part in resolving it. Are there any further points that you want to convey to the committee today, either yourself or any of your team, before we...
I don't think conclude? So, other than just to thank again the committee's support for this work on fiscal sustainability. I think that the committee's support has been really encouraging for us, and it's given us a lot of confidence in doing this work and moving into new areas. And I think we wouldn't have been able to do that without the support of this committee. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you for yet another excellent report. We have got a commitment from the Deputy First Minister to have a debate on fiscal sustainability between now and the summer recess. So we'll continue to press on that. But I want to thank you today for all your evidence and for asking your questions. And also hope that members will come tomorrow to actually... The spice event at 8:30 to 9:30, bacon rolls and scrambled eggs included in the Holyrood room. Okay, so look forward to seeing you again tomorrow. With that, we'll have a five-minute break in order to allow witnesses and official reports to leave and give members a natural break. Thanks. Public proceedings finished for the day. We'll move into private session. Thank you.